Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. It's nice to be in Berwyn. It's hot in the land of Israel. If I can, pray with us. Oh Lord, thank you for this time. Thank you for your word. Thank you for bringing me here to speak to these people. Thank you that through your blood, you give us all a righteousness we don't earn on our own. And we praise you, and we rejoice, and we wait for you from heaven. In Jesus' name, amen. Yes, my name is Paul, and I'm from Tarsus. Tarsus is a small city in the province of Rome. And my name was not always Paul, but my name used to be Saul. I was a full-blooded Jewish man. And let me tell you a little bit about how I grew up. I grew up in a strict Jewish upbringing. My family, when I grew up after being circumcised, on the day I was supposed to be circumcised, I grew up with a pedagogue that walked around me. Now let me tell you what a pedagogue is. A pedagogue is like a taskmaster. Someone who's older than you, who walks around and makes sure that when you do the wrong thing, that they tell you that you did the wrong thing. Or if you're going and you're going to the market and you're gonna buy something that maybe you shouldn't buy because it's not clean, the taskmaster, he won't let you buy it. So everywhere I went, I had this man following me, making sure I didn't get out of line at all. And then I got home, and my parents, who were devoted Jewish people, they would teach me the law. They would teach me the Ten Commandments, and they would show me how important it was to know the law, to have it written on my heart, to have it written on my hands and on my forehead. And then as I grew older, I was able to go and be trained by a man named Gamaliel. And he was a well-known Jewish leader and teacher. He taught me all I needed to know about interpreting the law, about how we should avoid walking a certain amount of steps on the Sabbath day, on the holy day. He also showed me that I needed to avoid people who were not Jewish. He showed me how I needed to be clean and cleansed by the washings using water every day and every time I came home. But then I met someone on the Damascus Road, someone named Jesus Christ, someone who I was persecuting. And he turned me into a missionary. And he turned me into a missionary for about 25 or 30 years. And not only was I a missionary, but I also made tents. I took goat hair and I wove it together and I made panels of cloth that could be used as tents so that people could live in them. That was my trade as I made money to fund my mission work. And I'm a guy who likes to write a lot of letters. I like to write letters to the people I care about. I like to write letters to the people that I've been able to introduce to Jesus Christ and make sure that they're growing in their faith. And so I'm going to give you a little overview of a letter that I wrote to people in Philippi. And these were my brothers. You know, the church, they're brothers, they're family. And so I'm encouraged to write to them because I didn't really have any family. As I got older, my parents died and I didn't have any siblings to call upon. So I had my church family. And I wanted them to have joy, to rejoice. Because when they were looking at the circumstances of this world, they were getting discouraged. And I wanted to have them, instead of looking down, I wanted them to look up. Because there was joy up there. There's a future and a hope to expect greater things. And so I told them to rejoice because it was safe and protective for them. If they rejoice, then they'll be protected from being discouraged and they'll be protected from giving up in their faith. Even though I was in prison at the time when I wrote to them, I still needed to write to them because I knew how important it was. They were far away from me, and I was not able to lead them, and that's a burden to bear myself. But I wanted to warn them because there are these enemies out there. There are these dogs. There are these evil workers and false teachers, false Jewish teachers, who try to teach you that, yes, you can believe in Jesus Christ, but you also need to follow the law of Moses in order to be pleasing to God. And I thought, well, that's not important because Jesus came and fulfilled the law for us. And he died in our place. Why would we need to earn it if he earned it for us? And so I had to warn them to watch out because these teachers are selfish. And these teachers have lusts that they try to fulfill. And you can see in their behavior that they do not follow Jesus Christ. And so I wanted to alert them to the fact that these teachers who say they were Jewish, they really weren't Jewish in the sense that God means Jewish. They weren't circumcised in their hearts. They might have been circumcised physically, but their hearts were still uncircumcised. And I wanted to tell them that, and I want to tell you this, that you are the circumcision. You are the people of God who worship God in the Spirit and glory in Christ Jesus. And you don't put any confidence in the flesh. You don't put any confidence in your good works or the deeds you have done, but you put confidence in the Lord Jesus Christ. If anybody was to have confidence in the flesh, confidence in the things that they have done to achieve a good status before God, it was me. I was born in every way a person of the Jewish faith of God. I was born on Hebrew of Hebrews. I was born in Palestine, the Holy Land. I was also of the chosen nation Israel, who were brought out of Egypt by God himself through miraculous wonders. That was me. I was of the tribe of Benjamin even, the tribe who were warriors, the tribe who always was faithful to Judah, even when the other tribes were bad. And we fought against our own people when they were going wrong. That's where I came from. I was also a Pharisee. Let me tell you about the Pharisees. We were a group of people who were separated from the people that were unclean. We were so holy, we couldn't be around anybody that wasn't clean, that wasn't righteous. And we separated ourselves. And we were also very zealous and warrior-like. And when I say the word zealous, it challenges me because I had a zeal, and I used that zeal to persecute the church. And it's not something I'm happy about. I'm ashamed of it. In fact, I think we have some footage to show you. I want to show you because I want to be open and honest with you about who I used to be. And I believe we have a clip of that.
Be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. You can all be baptized for the forgiveness of your sins. He was crucified, but he rose from the dead.
Impossible. Don't listen to him.
Why do you resist Jesus? He is your savior.
The way to everlasting life.
Jesus is dead! And you will go the same way. Blasphemer!
No! Jesus is alive. They tried to kill him, but they failed. He is a true prophet. I'm a messiah.
What do you know about the prophets? Your prophet put himself above the law. This boy knows nothing.
I know the scriptures.
Really? And you'll know Deuteronomy. Because he sought to entice you away from the Lord, your God. Your hands shall be the first against him, and you shall stone him with stones until he dies!
That's enough, sorry. I can bear to watch it. That was me. That was me. I was a zealous man, and I was there when Stephen was killed in the name of Jesus. And I was approving of it. You know, I used to drag Christians out of their houses by their hair because they were not following the law of God. That was me. I was willing to do violence, and I even did it legally. I got the letters from the high priest to convict these people, so I thought, of these crimes of blasphemy, so I could have them put in prison. That was me. A persecutor of the church, a persecutor of Jesus Christ. Thank God he had mercy on me, because I did it in ignorance. I thought I was doing the right thing, and I don't even like to say that, but I did. I thought I was sticking up for God when I was persecuting him and doing violence against his body. And whatever I thought I was good at, keeping the law, being a Pharisee, being from the tribe of Benjamin, being a Jew, being from Palestine, being zealous, I said, those things are loss. That's garbage to me, because Jesus struck me down when I was on my way to Damascus. He struck me off my horse, threw me to the ground. I couldn't see. I was blinded. Who are you, Lord? I said. He said, I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. It's hard for you to fight against me, he said. I couldn't say anything. I was fighting against the Lord, Jesus, the one I thought was dead, the one I wanted to silence through his people. I said, all those things that I've accomplished are worth nothing. Amen. And I put it in my mind. Status, achievements, the fact that I had wealth, it's all worthless. And more than that, it's even worthless because I really want to know Jesus Christ, even if I have to suffer like he suffered. And I did suffer like he suffered. I was stoned, just like Stephen was. I was left for dead, but I didn't die. I was later revived, because God had more work for me to do. I was shipwrecked several times. I tried to tell the captain of the ship that we needed to get all the cargo overboard so we could be safe and the ship would be light enough, but they didn't listen. And then the ship broke apart and we were swimming towards the shore. I was also bitten by poisonous snakes. And I was also put in jail and under house arrest for the name of Jesus Christ, but I still couldn't get past the burden that I was the worst sinner there could ever be. I felt I was the worst because I was the one persecuting people of God in the name of God. It's a shame. But I knew that God had mercy on me, and I know that when I die, I want to be found in Him. I want to be found not having my own righteousness, which is by the law. Love your neighbor as yourself. Love your enemies. Honor your father and mother. Do not steal. Do not lie. Do not cheat. Do not commit adultery. Do not covet. Those I've all failed at, especially coveting and pride. But I want to be found with faith that trusts that Jesus' righteousness is given to me. Amen. That trusts that on the basis of complete faith in Christ, He declares me righteous. He considers me to have fulfilled the law, even though I can't. Hallelujah. Through the faithfulness of Christ, I am able to have righteousness. And I just want to know Him. I want to know Him. I want to experience Him. I want to see His power work, the same power that raised Him from the dead. I want to be a part of that. I want that to be at work in my life. Amen. Not violence. And Jesus said, take up your cross. If I have to, I want to take up my cross and die for Him. Because I want to be there when He soon comes again, when He raises us from the dead and gives us new bodies. You know I haven't gotten to the point that I want to get at yet, but I'm still trying to get there. Hallelujah. I'm fighting. I'm pressing on. I'm pushing forward each step I can take so that I can lay hold of the prize at the end of the race, just like Jesus is the one laying hold of me. But I have to do one thing, and so do you. You have to forget what's in the past, and you have to look forward to what's ahead. Because God's calling you from up above. Amen. You can't be looking in the past. I have things to forget. Pulling people out of their houses, violating their private space. I'm ashamed of those. Every time I see that or people ask me about Stephen, I feel guilty all over again for that. I have to choose to let go and look up and look forward. Amen. Because there's a prize. And the prize is Christ Jesus.
Hallelujah!
Thank Paul for being here. Thank you, Paul, as he leaves. We were glad to have Paul as a guest. I mean, you guys have all read his books, you know, and he's just a really good guy. He founded all the churches that we worship in nowadays, most of them. Amen. And so he didn't take a lot of money to get him here. He's really willing to do this. But I want to tell you four things, based upon what he just shared with us. I want to tell you four things. But the main thrust of what he was saying was, he was trying to tell you what aim you should have as you try to gain Christ. What should be your aim as you seek to gain Christ? What should be your motive? What should be your goal? What should drive you? And the first thing is, you should seek to avoid spiritual imposters. Seek to avoid spiritual players, spiritual frauds. Because he tells us, watch out for those dogs. And in this case, he means dogs that are unclean. Amen. Teachers that are going around telling you it's okay to be immoral, telling you it's okay to lust after anything. Jesus will forgive you. Teachers who care about the outward more than the inward. Right. Teachers who are all about themselves, who are all about prosperity. He's saying, watch out for those guys. Watch out for those false circumcised people. The people that claim the name of God but are not really of God. Watch out for them. How should I watch out for them? When you're crossing the street, watch out, because they might be coming by. When you turn on your TV, they might be there. They might be at the train, trying to hand you literature. Watch out. Yesterday, I was crossing the street, and we were walking from, we went out to eat with a couple, and we were walking across the street, and it's a busy street downtown, and you know the law in Illinois says if someone's in the crosswalk, the cars are supposed to stop. Do you know that? That's a state law. They have those little signs in the middle of the road. They're yellow with the stripes. There's a picture of a guy walking. Does everybody know what I'm talking about? If someone's in the crosswalk, the car is supposed to stop. The person walking has the right of way. And so here I was with these people, and I was leading them across the street, and I was listening to what they were saying, and I was engaged in the conversation. And we walked halfway across the street, and we made it okay. And I just kept going because I assumed they're going to stop for me, but I wasn't consciously thinking about it. And here comes this car, and it's going really fast. And everyone else in the group stopped because they saw the car coming. But I kind of, in my subconscious, just assumed the car was going to stop. And, you know, he kind of got close to hitting me, and I kind of like went like that because I was like, what are you doing? But I needed to watch out. I still needed to watch out because there are those people out there that think they have the right of way. I've even seen some places where the sign used to be and it's gone, like somebody ran it over. You gotta watch out. There's people out there. They want to take advantage of you. They want to manipulate you. They just want you for their gain. And so we need to be careful. We need to look at their message. What are they saying? Is it biblical? Is it jive with the scripture? Or is it, does it sound weird? If it sounds weird, we need to check it. Check it in the scripture. Ask them where they get it from. Where'd you get that from? What scripture were you thinking of? We got to watch out for people who also have immoral behavior in their teachers. They're immediately disqualified from being teachers. Nowadays, it's becoming more commonplace that morality is not even a factor in your qualification to be a teacher. And also, they sometimes are outward focused. You got to do this. You got to look this way. You got to do this. You got to be there at this time and this. When really your heart, do they care about your heart? Are they a shepherd? Are they leading you beside quiet waters? Are they patient with you? God is patient with all of us. Amen. Shouldn't they be patient with you? Everybody, we're messing up all the time. If everyone pointed out every flaw we had, that's all we'd be doing. God wants us to have patience with each other. The second thing is, you need to know that it is good to lose if it's Christ that you choose. You need to know that it is really good to lose if it's Christ that you choose. Now, for Paul, he told us that he considered all his achievements, his nationality, his ethnicity, his religious upbringing that didn't really fit with his new belief in God, his former living, the way he lived his life, he said, that stuff is loss. I considered it like I lost a big bet. But I didn't just lose a bet. I got Christ. And it was for Christ I was willing to do that. I mean, he was a really powerful man in the Jewish faith, and he just was taken to nothing. And he had a mental resolve in his head. I will consider my achievements to be loss. And he had to keep doing that because there was something in him that wanted to challenge him to be prideful. And he always fought against that. Does anybody have gauge earrings? Okay, good. I'm going to pick on them. You know those earrings that are really, really thick? And if you take them out, you got a big hole in your ear, you could see through it? Or like they look like pieces on like a puzzle board or like a game puzzle piece? Gauge earrings. What do you guys think of those? They're okay, I guess, if you want to have them, but to me, I don't know. I don't really dig them. And I have that position. I have that view, like, ah, I'm not going to get those kinds of earrings. Or I'm not going to get, like, trying to make sure. Anybody pierced up here? It's fine. I just, for me, it's like, this is what I think. I'm just not going to do that. Or whatever it may be for you. Maybe you have convictions on certain things, and you know that other people have convictions about those things that are different. And they're not necessarily right or wrong, but you hold to them in your heart firmly. That's what Paul did. He held firmly to the fact that his achievements were not worth anything to him anymore. That was his view on his own previous life as a religious man. He had to let it go. And so that's what we need to do. We need to kind of have that mental stronghold in our life that says, this is what I believe about Christ. This is what I believe about his death, his resurrection. It all happened. It was all there. It was true. We have eyewitnesses. And I'm going forward in that. Everything else is loss. The third thing, you should strive to gain Christ, even if it includes suffering. Paul, it's really strange. He talks about, and the summary that Paul gave us was from Philippians 3, 1 through 14. And he's talking about participating in the sufferings of Christ. And I think the back of his mind, there was the idea that Christ said, take up your cross and get on my road and follow me, and maybe you're going to have to die for me, Paul. And Paul did die for Christ. He was beheaded in Rome in the year about 62 or so. He was killed for his faith. But he knew that he was going to be persecuted by his own people because he knew how zealous his people were for the law and how they would reject Christ. And so he says, I count all things loss in view of the surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things. And I count those things as rubbish. Amen. You guys know what rubbish is? Garbage, trash, basura. Is there any other words? He put his garbage behind the cross. And that wasn't just sins he had done. Those were accomplishments, achievements, things he was proud of. He had to put them behind him. He had to strip them off so he could have a lighter weight so he could move forward and gain Christ. Amen. But he wanted to be found in Christ. He had that nagging feeling in his back of his mind that said, man, you were a bad guy. You know, towards the end of his life, he said, I am the chief of sinners. In Timothy, have you read that? I am the worst, the chief. The chief is on the top. There he was saying, I'm worse than everybody else in the category of sinning. Because I even took God's church and tried to destroy it. Well, towards the end of your life, Paul, you felt that way? You felt that way even though God grew you in so many areas and used you to change the world? Yeah, he still felt that way. That's how humbled he was. And that's how much it nagged on his conscience. And so, Paul wanted to be found having faith in Christ Jesus. And now if there's something so important in this message that you need to catch, it's this part right here. It says, not having my own righteousness, which is derived from the law. Where do you get righteousness from? You get righteousness when you follow the law. When you keep a commandment, that's being righteous. Therefore, you're righteous. Paul says, no, you can't keep the law. The law is there to show us how much we've broken it. There's nothing wrong with the law. There's something wrong with us. We start out on the wrong foot. We start out with a sinful nature. That's right. As we grow up, our sinful nature comes out. Our true colors show. Any of you guys with kids, can you answer that? Kids sin sometimes? All the time? Yeah. And as adults, we do a more sophisticated fashion. But he says, he doesn't leave us without hope. Because righteousness is not based upon the law. It's based upon that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness which comes from God. Hallelujah! So when you get a gift, Maybe you've given yourself a gift before. But usually when you get a gift, it's from someone else, right? You didn't tell them, you didn't like plan it out, and you didn't go buy it, and you didn't wrap it, and you didn't put a card on it or a bow. But when it was given to you, that person did all that. All you really did was receive it. That's what he's saying. He's saying God considers righteousness something you obtain by faith. Amen. And then there's a word in here. It says the faithfulness of Christ. Christ was faithful to the law to a T. He was born without the sinful nature. That's why he had to be conceived in the womb by the Holy Spirit. But fulfilling the law was not just what he was here for. He was able to die for us so that his sacrifice pleases God's anger. God is angry at sin. But when someone puts their faith in Jesus Christ, God is no longer angry, or you're no longer an enemy of him. You're his friend. You've made a peace treaty with him. And that's the blood of Christ. So he considers you righteous. It's as if you had a bunch of money put into your bank account, enough that you needed to pay the debt that you owed, and it wasn't put there by you. It was put there by God. Righteousness comes from God. Can you say that? Righteousness comes from God. Amen. Amen. I just want to tell you about a little bit about Paul and his idea of loss. So he was saying, everything that I considered in the past is loss. I lost it. And you know, guys, we've gone through some interesting financial things in the last few years, right? Financial collapse, economic meltdown, bailouts. But the loss part was good for Paul because he needed to get to that point in order to see that gaining Christ was everything. Amen. But sometimes what we do, and I'm not trying to criticize the government or anything, but the fact that we bail out companies and they don't experience the difficulty of a loss can work against the fact that they might turn to God for their needs. That's right. And if you look in history, in the revivals that have happened in this country in the 1850s, there was a revival that spread like wildfire. And it was only revival that happened through prayer. It was one guy in New York City near Wall Street, and there's still a statue of him there today. His name was Jeremiah Lanphier. And he was a guy who one day decided that he wanted to start a men's business prayer meeting during the lunch hour, during the weekday lunch hour. And he started it in New York, and the first day there was just a couple people there. But then every week that went by, it would multiply by 5, by 10. Within a month, they had like hundreds of people there, and they weren't preaching. They weren't preaching. They were just praying. And God was moving on people. And what they would do is they would start praying for someone that they knew to come to Christ. And the next day, that person would be at the meeting, and they would be like, I want to put my faith in Christ. The Holy Spirit was moving so strong during those times. And it was a time of economic distress. If you research it in history, you learn that people were unsure about the economy. It was really like similar to this time. And they didn't have a bailout. And people started turning to God. And also there's this story that some sailors were coming in the harbor on a ship. And they were making noise, and the captain said, look, guys, be quiet because the Holy Spirit is moving in this city. And as soon as he told them about what was going on, they were immediately stopped by the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit got them, connected to them. And they were feeling the Spirit moving, and he moved in Canada, and he moved in Europe across the ocean. It's an amazing thing to read about. And so loss is not necessarily a bad thing sometimes. And I think the way we apply that is we think, you know, sometimes when you are going to stand for Christ, you're going to stand alone. You're going to be the only one standing, and you might lose a friend, or you might lose talking back and, you know, I'm going to get right by saying the right, you know, say something back to them. You might seem to lose by being quiet and being humble or by being righteous. But you really gain. You really win in God's category in those moments. And so we need to be willing to lose sometimes. The last thing is this. You should aim to forget and move past your past. If you're driving on the road and your past is standing there on the side of the road trying to hitchhike, yo, give me a ride, bro. You put on the gas. You go. You can't be hitchhiking, giving no ride to the past. You got to look forward. How many of us have pasts? Ooh. And they come and try to boss us around. The past is not your boss. What does he mean by past? Well, Paul said, forgetting what is behind. Forgetting what is behind. It's like, did you ever get memory loss on purpose? This is when you should do it. When things start coming up or someone's accusing you, like Satan or whatever, anybody who accuses you of things you did like a long time ago, things that Christ has covered, that's in your pet. I don't remember that. You don't say that, but in your heart. Amen. He says forgetting what is behind. It's an active choice to forget. Even if it's reminded to us, we need to forget. Because if we're looking back, we can't see what's up front. How are we going to drive like that? Remember that one movie where the guy was like turning around talking, Dumb and Dumber or whatever? And he was talking to the guy, he wasn't looking. Or sometimes you turn your head to look and your hand goes with the steering wheel. Can't do that. Got to look forward. Amen. Now, Paul had many things to forget, as we already said. He wanted to forget what he did to Stephen. He was the one who held their coats. So when they took off their jackets to stone Stephen, he was the one like holding them. And he's like, go ahead, guys, I'll watch your coats while you do this. He was approving of it. That's what it means. He had also other things to forget. And like I mentioned earlier, dragging people out of houses, persecuting them, hunting them down, breathing down their necks. A bounty hunter after Christians. That was Paul. He wanted to forget that because God had changed him. There was a guy that I used to be a skateboard guy, okay, when I was younger. And I used to skateboard every day. And there was an older guy that skated with us, and he was really good, and, you know, we always looked up to him. And I skated with him many times. And then a few years go by, and I see him on the train, and he's sitting, like, right there. And I was like, hey, Steve, how are you? He was like, who are you? I was like, Steve. I remember we used to skate. Remember I had a ramp and used to come to my house and used to skate on it. And we used to go to these places and, you know, skate there. And remember this guy that we used to know and this other guy? He didn't remember me. I don't remember. I don't know what you're talking about. I don't know you. He chose to forget me. Amen. It was weird. I told a guy about that the other, like a couple months ago. I said, hey, I saw Steve one time, and he was like, he forgot me. And he was like, yeah, Steve, he's weird. He's kind of stuck up or whatever. So he chose to forget me. Now, we need to choose to forget our past sins. Sins in the past, wins in the past, things we've done well. We can't rely upon those. There's more good things to do ahead. It's not just what we did in the past. God, I did this for you 5 years ago. No, there's more to do now. And we need to think, how often are we looking up to heaven? How often are we thinking about eternity? Guys, this life is a blip. And eternity is a long time. Amen. Paul was like, my focus is upward. We're looking for Jesus to come back. We're looking for things that are going to last for eternity. And so we can't hold on to our past sins. Jesus, wash them away. Now, if you would, take out your piece of paper. This says, my top three accomplishments and or things I am proud of, mis tres mejores logros. Hopefully that's a good translation. Hopefully you wrote on these. I hope everyone did. If you didn't, please really quickly write three things that you've either you're proud of, you've done right, or you're glad to be, I'm glad I am 100% this, or I'm glad, you know, my dad was the senator or president of this, or whatever it is. And I want you to carry this with you, because Paul said, I count everything as rubbish, garbage, trash, in light of gaining Christ. And what I want you to do, I want you to come make a line down the middle and just tear it up and put it in here. Maybe you want to write some sins you've done on the back. You tear them up and count them as garbage for the sake of knowing Christ. I mean, there's times maybe God leads us. We run into someone we used to mistreat or hurt. God will open the door for us to get forgiveness from them. But remember, before God in you, there's no enemy. You're not an enemy when you put your faith in Christ. And so if you could, please come down the center. Just come up to this trash can and just tear it up. Them all as garbage. I have more things to do. What I want to do right now is I want to pray. I want to pray for everyone. And I want some of our ministers, just if you could stand. You can keep the music going, it's okay. And Mrs. Funches, can you stand in the back? Leah wants, Cecile, do you want to stand back there? We're just going to pray over all these people, all of us. I just want God to lead you to pray for them, for everyone, as you feel to pray. And you guys in the sitting, you pray for us. Pray for yourselves, pray for us. Pray for people you know that are following the wrong path. They're trying to get everything from this world, and they're trying to get nothing from God. And if God leads you to pray for someone specifically, you can. Or if you want specific prayer for someone, raise your hand. We'll come to pray with you. Okay? Keep your hand up, please. I want to pray for her. Lord, thank you. Thank you for what you've done for us. We praise you, God. We praise you for what you've done. We praise you for the good things you've done. God, we ask you, please touch us. Please send your Holy Spirit into us, upon us. God, help us to want to be people who have faith in Christ, who rely upon you for our needs, for our righteousness, Lord. People who don't look to our own goodness to be accepted by you, but people who look to faith in Christ, what Christ accomplished. We thank you. We thank you for this, Lord. In Jesus' name.